Welcome to another episode of the Big J and Little J Show, where unfortunately this is back-to-back losses. Connor, Duke lost again. They lost to NC State 74-69. But first, we got an ad. Autograph, Connor. Autograph. The Autograph app is where your fandom lives. The app gives diehard fans like you access to all the best college sports content, fan challenges, and exclusive rewards like crazy discounted tickets, exclusive merchandise, and more. You can unlock rewards like these just for doing the things you already do as a fan, like listening to this podcast, following news on your current team like Connor at Devils Illustrated, sharing your favorite content, and more. Download the free Autograph app in the Apple Store and use referral code DEVIL, that is D-E-V-I-L-L, DEVIL, D-E-V-I-L-L. That's referral code DEVIL, D-E-V-I-L-L, and we'll see you at the game. Hopefully, Connor, that game will be a first-round win against whoever Duke plays in March Madness, because now Duke has me officially worried. You know I've been on the pro-Duke bandwagon for over 30 games now, and last night it was like – it was like the fan on Major League 2, Connor. I had my Cleveland Indians shirt, and I was ready to go for the season. And then all of a sudden, by the end of it, I'm just having an X over it, and he's angry. That's me right now.
I'm sitting here trying to remember. You've referenced that before, and I don't remember what brought that on. Was it a football game?
Yeah, it was a Duke football game. Okay. I don't know what football game it was, but I think it was just Cutcliffe's last couple seasons. I just kept using that as like a Twitter meme.
I thought it might have been the two-point conversion explainer.
That you could have used that night.
Almost make Celsius come through your nose, that one.
Yeah, you could have used it that night for sure. Connor went to war that night on Twitter.
I mean, the coach is gone, and I'm still going to have to explain to people the two-point conversion math, aren't I?
Hopefully Manny Diaz is on the same boat for you, so then you can parlay that into this season. And, you know, we'll be talking about Duke football here in about a month with spring ball around the corner.
Yeah, gosh. Don't remind me that spring football has practices that we actually have to cover. No, I mean, it's a bad way to go into the NCAA tournament. It's not just – like, we always want to dive in more than just telling you, well, this team lost two games. They're done. They're cooked. They're not making it out of the first weekend. It's the way they've lost these games. It's the way they've played that really inspire the least amount of confidence you could possibly have in a team. Like, the energy and effort is just not there. I don't think you need – I think Pitt had 39 bench points. 30 of them came from Ish Leggett against Wake Forest yesterday. I don't think you need a ton of scoring on your bench, but you need your bench players to be playable and like give you something when they enter the game. Duke got absolutely nothing out of the four that entered. And I say four, that's kind of unfair to Jalen Blakes because he played one defensive possession. But they got nothing out of TJ Power, Sean Stewart, Ryan Young. And when Caleb Foster is out, and as I said on Twitter, since the question is going to come up, I understand why the question comes up. Duke needs him back, but the status really hasn't changed. Like, Caleb Foster is still walking around with his right foot in a boot. He uses the knee rover, that little push cart thing that you just elevate your knee on to move everywhere other than like walking in and out of huddles during games, like leaving and coming onto the court. He's using that thing. Leaving the locker room yesterday, he was using that thing. Like, I really don't see a path back for him this season unless Duke is somehow in Phoenix and maybe he plays there. But it's just when you've got three guards that you want to play and start and need big minutes out of, and all three of them have really pretty poor performances. Doesn't matter if your big men go for 46 and what, 18 or 22 or whatever they combine for in rebounds. It's going to be a bad game.
Yeah. I mean, we shot 28. We were, the guards for Duke were 7 of 28,
23 points. I know that number off the top of my head because I was in the story. Yeah, I mean, it's two games in a row that Jeremy Roach has pressed. It's flummoxing. Talking to him after the game was a little bit strange. Like, he was very much on the approach of, he felt like it was the exact same situation as 2 years ago when they lost in the ACC tournament championship to Virginia Tech. I don't get that feeling. Like, that team played two decent games before then. They beat Miami and Syracuse.
Yeah.
And it felt like that washed out the taste of the last home game under K. So this team has lost back-to-back games doing a lot of the same things. Like Jared McCain and Mark Mitchell said them both best. I think Kyle Filipowski had a quote that I need to get to also. I haven't listened to it yet, but like they keep losing games because of the things they can control. That's the main thing. Like Jared McCain, the best shooter on the team, has talked about he can live with missing shots. And every basketball player will tell you, like, you're going to miss shots. Nobody shoots 100% other than Blake Henson on his one night. What you can't do is you can't get out-hustled and out-muscled and just ever get punked. Like, they get punked.
Yeah, like, they got punked. I mean, 50-50 balls are 90-10 for the other team and Duke losses. And they're probably 60-40 for the opposing team and Duke wins. Duke just has been scoring at such an effective clip that they cover up all their, like, blemishes with their offense. Like, when McCain's hitting and the guards are hitting, it's fun to watch. And they were 5 of 20 from 3, I think, something like that, last night. It. And they were just terrible offensively. But I got clipped up on my video breakdown that's gaining some traction on Twitter, is that Duke just was abysmal defensively. Like, it was borderline high school basketball defense. And that's where I was the most concerned about. And obviously he's very concerned about it too. So he's barking exactly how I was barking at the TV last night at work at the bar. Just get a stop. But I mean, it was laughable. Like, we'll talk about McCain because I want to dive in on Duke's defensive stuff like later in this episode. But Keats said this after the game, and he said, we talk about our conditioning and how it pays off for us. When you look at these three games that we played, honestly, we've looked like the more fresh team than anybody. And I agree to that. Last night, they looked fresher than Duke. Obviously, DJ Burns aside, their guard play looked legit. And I see, like, Duke Twitter saying, well, Roach might be dealing with an injury and stuff. And that may be true, but I'm not going to speculate an injury or non-injury. I'm strictly talking about performance-based. And also, DJ Horn just came back from a hip injury that he's still suffering from. Yeah. He was the best player on the court guard-wise last night.
Yeah, it's also in the story. Like, you could not tell down the stretch last night which team was the one that hadn't played yet in D.C. and which one was playing its third game in as many days. That's – I mean, you can't – again, you cannot control how the other team plays. You can't control how you play. And when you look sluggish, when you're the team that earned a top four seed – and don't take advantage of it because you look like you've gotten too much rest or whatever it is. You have rust that needs to be knocked off. Like, you know, I was talking to Brett Friedlander of Saturday Road. And like, typically when you get a team that's going into its third or fourth game in a tournament, you can see them come out hot. Like, they'll always have that initial burst where, hey, they've been playing here. They understand the depth behind the baskets, like everything that goes into playing in a new arena.
Yeah.
They've got the advantage over the team that hasn't played yet. But then it's always the last 30 to 35 minutes of the game. It's like, oh yeah, the team that's rested, the team that's the better team in the regular season, like, they take over. And that was not the case. Yeah. My parents' dog here, Zella, I'm home. She's a barker. She's a little bit more of a barker than Bo at home back in K-Vegas.
Isn't that just podcasting, though? Just people barking through microphones, so it's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, to go off of that, Connor, you're a baseball guy, and so I just think of it as baseball. Like, like not even the ACC tournament, but you look at the A-10, I think the top four seeds are knocked out. So it's like the 5 and 7 and the 8 and 10 are playing in the semifinals. So something weird like that. And my thing is you see that in baseball and MLB. As a Braves fan, they had the historically the best offense in MLB history this past season. And then the Phillies played in the wild card. They won, and they were the team that had a rhythm going into the NLDS, and they knock out the Braves. And it's like the Braves couldn't hit a fastball down the middle because they looked rusty. And this analogy goes with Duke. Like, yeah, they lost to UNC, but they had a couple of days off, and NC State's 3 games in 3 days. And besides DJ Burns, all those guys are in great condition. I mean, Morsell looked good, and Horn is who he is. He only played 2 games in 2 days because he missed the Louisville game. And so, like, it's just frustrating, man. It's frustrating that Duke showed no resilience. Like, it's the way, like you said, Duke's lost. 3 out of the 4 halves, they haven't led. And then the one half they did lead, it was very briefly.
What, 3 out of 4 halves?
Like, the whole UNC game, so they didn't lead at any of those halves.
Oh, and then
First half against NC State.
Right. But yeah, you're talking –
yeah, that very brief lead in the first half. And that should have – they should have capitalized. I thought – I know it was early in the game, but I thought when Duke finally got the lead that they could not get against UNC, they were going to separate themselves. And then even when they went back and forth a little bit, I'm like, just close the half. This back-to-back halves Duke had where it was a buzzer beater that, like, just killed momentum. Any momentum Duke could have had.
Duke has been so hot or cold in end of first half situations, and that probably kills Shire almost as much as anything else with this team. Because, like, going 2 for 1, end of half, getting 50-50 balls, doing all the stuff that is supposed to be hardwired into Duke and the way the program operates that he wanted to carry over from Coach K. This team just sometimes decide it's almost like it's just a conscious decision. Like, sometimes they do it, sometimes they don't. And you never know which one it's going to be.
Yeah.
You never know which version of that's going to show up. And I think that's where you land on why this is so frustrating, because this was not supposed to be the Duke team that was yin and yang and you couldn't figure out what you were going to get. You can stomach that being a freshman team, like being a one and done factory, having a bunch of freshmen that are just there for 9 months. This is supposed to be the team that doesn't do that because they have 3 sophomores and a senior leading them.
Yeah.
That's where you land on this. Man. Would you believe me if I said that she hadn't been barking for like the last hour?
Yeah, she has to get it out.
Yeah, I think people are coming home from work and there's work going on next door, and she will not stop. Man, this is not going very well.
It's okay.
But yeah, like that's where, you know, look, this team is capable of making a run. I can't stress that enough. Like everything about this team and when it was going well, even without Caleb Foster, they won what, three straight?
Yeah, about double 25 and 15 or something like that.
Right.
And I know it's Louisville, Virginia, and them, but I mean, shit, still.
Well, two of those teams are playing tonight for a chance to go to the ACC championship game.
Good point. So
there must be something good about them, right?
Yeah, good point.
Yeah. So, like, it's still a Duke team that's capable of getting things right. The NCAA tournament is all about matchups. That's why it's so dumb to place any kind of, like, end all be all scenarios on it, because you can get the right matchups and get through.
You saw that with UNC a couple years ago when they were like the 8 seed, because that region, and that's not me making an excuse, that is facts, like they matched up so well with Baylor and you saw what happened and
got up 30 on Baylor and beat them in overtime.
Yeah, because the crazy stuff when Manic went out, like that just was a whole — that whole game was the craziest, like, sequence of officiating. Everything about that game was wild. But that whole region set up perfectly for UNC. And like you said, it's all about matchups. And Duke's benefited from matchups and made deep runs. And Duke's also been screwed on matchups and lost in early first, second rounds like last year against Tennessee. It just happens.
Yeah. So, and this is where, like, the – the cloud of last year still follows this. It's followed this team all year because it's a lot of the same pieces. So you're just sitting there thinking, like, is this team going to get out physical? And 8 losses, where would you rank being out muscled and pushed around on the list of reasons why Duke lost each one of those 8 games?
Probably number 1.
Yeah. I mean, and that's where Mark Mitchell said, like, there's something common with every single game we've lost. And it's not just because we've had less points than the other team. Like, that's,
yeah, we get punched in the mouth. We, as in Duke, get punched in the mouth, and then Duke just does not. They try and battle back. The best way I can describe it is I don't think it's lack of fire. I think they put in the wrong energy. Like, when Duke is struggling and they're trying to battle back, they're looking for foul calls and they're going down. They're trying to leave it in the ref's hands rather than just, hey, you know what, just nut up, lock in, and play ball. Instead, it's like, all right, we're going to play hard, go to the rim, where's the foul? And then they get deflated that they missed the layup because they thought it was a foul, and they go back and give up a 3. And it's just like, that's not where the energy needs to go in the game. It's just those type of little things bother me the most.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's a tough way to watch a really talented basketball team play, because when you're doing that kind of stuff, you're playing under your talent level.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Roach said after the game they're going to have like a players meeting or something and whatever, hash things out. And look, I tweeted about it last night. It happened. We've done that, and I did that in college, and we had a bad loss, and a couple of teammates of mine, we lost by like 15, and one got mad at the other for being basically a ball hog. And he said, all right, meet me after the game. So coach stepped out of the locker room, and they threw hands. But I tell you what, a couple of days later, we won our next conference game by double digits. So I'm not saying, like, I'm pro-violence, but I am just saying that did happen, and I was a witness. And there is video somewhere with my teammates. But there was a stool that's been broken in the Ferrum locker room from some body slamming. So we came out sloppy and then had a team meeting, basically, and then that came through. Obviously, it's not going to happen with Duke, but I'm just saying, like, it is healthy to confront one another. Like, I know people want to have kumbaya, but look, Hurley and Leitner didn't like each other, and they won 2 national championships. And then I've seen Duke teams love each other, and they lost in round of 32. Doesn't really mean anything. Yeah. You just gotta connect at the right level at the right time in March.
Yeah. It was a while before Duke's locker room opened to us yesterday. You're supposed to have a 10-minute cooling off period. And I think Duke's locker room after that 10-minute period was still closed for about 20 minutes, which typically losing teams, they take their time a little bit more than winning teams, obviously. Especially in tournaments. But that was it got to the point where, like, the last 5 to 10 minutes, me and several other media members were looking at each other like, man, this is getting to the point where it's a little interesting. But we got in there and asked if they're, you know, what they were meeting about, what they were taking so long with, and I can't remember if it was Jeremy or Mark, but one of them said they weren't really talking about anything. It was more the coaches were meeting for a long time and then finally came in and talked to the players. So I mean, it seemed like the conversation was more coach to coach than it was anything the players had problems with.
I feel like the coaches were probably talking about, like, more so talking about the players behind the closed doors to figure out, like, where they wanted to attack, like, talking points.
100%.
Yeah, yeah. I thought you were saying, like, coach to coach, like Shire was addressing, like, Jay.
No, I don't think Shire was.
Yeah, yeah, like, yeah. I was just clarifying
out Emmanuel Dildy.
Yeah, no, that's what I was clarifying. That's what I figured you're going, but
no, I mean, and the coaches talked to the players enough during the game that I don't know if they really had anything more to say to them. Like, the where we were on Media Row, there were a couple other people that were closer than I was, but I was pretty close to Duke's bench. I mean,
it's not great. I could see the body language by Shire, especially that one segment that I clipped that it was a 2-on-2 fast break. Diarra misses the layup, and Duke has Proctor Power underneath the goal. Don't get the rebound. Horn does. He get out to Diarra, whatever his last name is, and he hits a 3. Shire just throws his fist up when Duke doesn't get a rebound, and then throws his fist up to call a timeout. And, like, that doesn't wake up your team. And that's what was most frustrating is Roach was involved in that. Like, your senior leader is involved in these plays. That's the disheartening part of it all. If it was Jared McCain and Sean Stewart, it's like freshmen. They just don't know any better. But it's your senior leader who's been in March and made deep runs. And it's just like, you know the pits of Duke and you know the top level of Duke. Like, you know what it takes.
McCain and Stewart play hard.
Yeah.
Like,
McCain does play hard, but he, God, defensively. Oh.
Yeah, his lateral quickness, I'm assuming, is what I didn't have a chance to watch the video, but.
Yeah, no.
I'm assuming lateral quickness is where most of your focus was spent.
The closeouts by Duke. I mean, Sean Stewart came in, first possession he was in, got face cut. That was the first 2 points for NC State. And then three or four possessions later, he overcloses out or bites on a jab step by Diarra, and that made him pay because Diarra put him in the rim and dunked on him. And then after that sequence, Shire just put him on the bench and basically buried him for the rest of the game. Because I understand Shire's coaching to where it's like, okay, you got to show me something in your stint, but I also think you need to give guys two stints, whether it's like 4 minute stretch here, 4 minute stretch there, because there's been plenty of times where a guy's had a bad 4 minute stretch, but then they've redeemed themselves. And so I wish he had a longer leash, but I understand also why he didn't, because his best two players were his front court. So there's no need to put Sean Stewart in when Mark Mitchell has 18 and played good defense. State was 4-14 against Mark Mitchell. So they shot 28% with Mark Mitchell guarding him. Shout out to Synergy. And then Filipowski, 28-14.
I've watched TJ Proctor stand at the top of the key and scream Sean Stewart's name enough times this year to understand that if he's being overcommitted and being too jumpy on defense and on the other side of the court doesn't know where he's supposed to be on certain plays and sets, probably best to leave him on the bench.
Yeah. Tyrese Proctor. Yeah. You said TJ Proctor, but I knew who you're talking about. I knew it wasn't TJ Power, but
TJ Power, 2025 point guard. Here it comes.
Just to go with flag playing, and you know, it's just, it's frustrating. And
it's a frustrating team, man. They're going to be a 3 seed, maybe a 4 seed, but I think they'll be a 3. So they're right on the borderline of being able to be choosy about where they get to go. Although I don't think the last 2 seed gets to be all that choosy. Like somebody has to go out west, basically. But look,
what sucks, Connor, is they beat Pitt by 30, and then a couple weeks later lost to Pitt. And then 10-11 days ago, I thought this was the best win of the season for Duke. Looks like they're really turning over that, like, the next page. And then UNC lost, but then losing to the same opponent in a totally different way. That's the part where I'm just frustrated about, because DJ Burns obviously had 27 first game. This time, 5 guys for NC State scored in double figures, led by DJ Horn. And it's just like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And I just don't know if it was the game plan or what. Because, I mean, Burns still shot 11 shots. He was 4 of 11. It's just everybody else was getting open, it seemed like.
I'll tell you that. And I think that's where, you know, here you want to record this. I just not going to, like, you want to credit your boy Kevin Keats a little bit. I don't know if it was him. I don't know if it was something an assistant did, but to me, it looked like DJ Burns was getting into his post-ups and actions a lot faster than he was anytime during the game, like 2 weeks ago. Like he was catching the ball and going. And I've watched a bit of DJ Burns last 2 years. A lot of his post-ups are catch the ball near the 3-point line, take 8 dribbles and try to make a move.
Yeah.
Like last night he was getting to his spots a lot earlier and quicker. You know, maybe that was all a rope-a-dope by lulling guys to sleep, and then they turn it on in the ACC tournament and win 2 more. Even though they at one point this week thought they only needed to win 1 more. Credit Luke DeCock's tweet on that one.
It happens.
Yeah, you know, everybody. Nobody can keep track of these. Nobody can keep track of these tournament brackets and all the all the requirements.
Yeah, you play four games, you might as well play. Like, if you're playing five games, you're going to forget that it's five. You might say it's six or four. Like, that. And they're in the moment celebrating. I'm not going to be like, well, actually, it was a funny tweet, though. It was a funny tweet because, obviously, I knew UNC fans were going to jump all over talking about NC State can't count. But, I mean, I make basic math mistakes daily, so it happens.
Sure. Who hasn't? But yeah, it's.
What do you think Duke needs to fix? What is something that you think Duke just needs to address that you saw against NC State?
It's got to be defensive intensity. Like, I go back to the proximity of the huddle. One of them, Jay Lucas, straight up told them, "We're doing shit that we haven't done all year on the defensive end. We're just making shit up." Like,
yeah,
the 32nd game of the year, and you're telling a team that, and the stakes have theoretically never been higher. Like, we can go back and forth on whether it means more for Duke to beat Carolina than to beat NC State in an ACC tournament game. And I do think the conference tournaments are losing a lot of their luster. But you want to put your best foot forward when it is a tournament. And you're making shit up on the fly and doing stuff on defense that really is just, like, unheard of.
You said Jay Lucas said that?
Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder if he's saying that, though, like, we're making shit up as in, like, the players are just doing whatever they want. We're not telling them to do this. They're just
No, that's what I mean.
That's what you're implying. I got.
Yeah. He just, like, you know, they're not playing to the principles that Duke's defense has played to all year.
No, they're not playing shell defense. They're not playing helps. They're not playing help the helper, at least against NC State. And to your point about, like, you know, what are you playing for, ACC tournament stuff? At the end of the day, coaches want to play for championships, whether it's regular season championship, conference tournament championship, or the championship. And so it also looks good on a resume, like, if Duke would win as a coach, that, hey, I was 2 years at Duke, won the ACC 2 years to get that next gig if he wants to be a head coach. And so I get that part of it. But and as a fan, you know, you don't take pride in being, hey, back-to-back ACC tournament champions, you know, because you never know what's happening in March. You know, the whole season would be a waste.
Off the top of my head, three teams in the ACC have won national championships since the last time a ACC team repeated as ACC champs. The last team to repeat was Duke from 09 to 11. So the first two of those were Shire. Duke won in 15, Carolina won in 17, Virginia won in 19. Then you throw in another couple Final Fours in there. Like, I guess there were no Final Fours for the ACC from like 2012 to 14. Duke 15, UNC in 16, 17. On download, like Miami last year.
You're doing a hell of a job because I didn't know. So yeah, I was too knocked my head with you.
2 years ago, Carolina and Duke there. Yeah. Anyway, like, a lot of good things have happened for the ACC in the span that it's like, and it's been hard to win that tournament. So if Duke could, that, like, that was at stake. I also saw something today that said no team has won the national championship going into the NCAA tournament on a losing streak of, you know, two games or more. So that matters for – it was in the context of, I think, Tennessee that I saw it because they got housed by Mississippi State and can't remember who they lost to in their regular season finale. Maybe – was that Kentucky?
Yes. Yeah, Reed Shepard. They beat them. Yeah, Reed Shepard went crazy.
Yeah, so – Tennessee and Duke, I think, are the two teams that are going to be top three seeds and going in on quite sour notes.
Yeah. I haven't watched much. I've watched a few games of Tennessee, but obviously not enough to figure out their problem. But like you said, Duke's problem at the end of the day is correctable. And it's just, it's just, you can make up bad defense with energy. Like, you can just make up with hustle plays, and because closeout's going to be messy. It's going to happen, but it's the little things of the second chance points of guys standing around when the ball goes up not boxing out. That's just infuriating. Just put a body on a body. Like, make a hard foul. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I know that sounds, in this day and age, like, whoa. But seriously, like, make a statement. A guy goes to the rim. You put him on the floor, a clean play. And whether you get an intentional foul or not, they know, just like Tennessee did against Duke in the second round of the tournament. Like, they came out, and you're like, whoa, this Tennessee team's playing dirty. No, they popped Duke in the mouth, and then they just controlled the rest of the game. Like, sometimes it just takes that moment to be the physical team. And I need to see that from Duke. Because defensively, Connor, we are soft. Like, my thumbnail was not misleading. Duke was very soft last night. And I want to get into these numbers for you. So, we already teased it with Jared McCain. I'll just go right into Jared McCain because he's the first one. And UNC picked on him, and now NC State basically did the nose, picked on him too. On the year, opposing players are shooting 42% from the field, 43% from three against Jared McCain. He's graded out as below average. Via synergy, he gave up 14 points versus NC State on 5-of-7 shooting. In his first game against NC State, he gave up 2 points on 1-of-4. So clearly NC State saw the homework and was like, go after him, because the UNC game before Duke, they had 15 points on 6-of-9 shooting.
Yeah.
And then the first time Duke played UNC, they had 11 points in 12 possessions. So they were going at McCain. And then his worst game of the year was Duke's loss against Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh had 17 points against him on 6-of-8 shooting. So they just – when people key in on McCain as the primary defender, they have success, and that's indicated in four of Duke's losses this season. It's like, go after McCain, because everybody else, Connor, is graded to be good to excellent on Duke's guards and bigs. But to go off of that, Jeremy Roach has declined, and Proctor from last season. Roach last year was an excellent defender. Now this year he's graded at very good, and Proctor went from very good to good. So I don't know what it is with Duke's guard play in terms of defense, but those two guys downgraded. And the only guy that's been consistent last year was Mark Mitchell.
I don't know. We had somebody just come to the door here. This is, man.
It's all good.
She's loud.
You can, if you mute unless you bark, like, that's fine. But Mark Mitchell, back-to-back years, graded out as excellent. And so he 32% against him this year, 21% from three, just locks people up. And then Flip actually made the jump from very good defender to excellent this season. He went from he's basically, his stats are 33% from the field against him, 26% from the three-point line. And lastly, the last defensive stat I want to give you for individually, which I found shocking because, you know, Sean Stewart, shot blocker, athlete. Well, he's giving up 50% twos from two, 14 of 28. He's graded at below average. Ryan Young is giving up 14 of 35 at 40%. So Ryan Young from the two-point defense is better than Sean Stewart, who is athletic. And it just goes to show that Ryan Young really does play well below the rim in comparison. And this, it's a veteran move, so he understands what's going on.
Yeah, that's the thing, that, like, Sean Stewart will get the blocks, but he'll also give them up because he's trying to get blocks.
Yeah.
I would like to have a dollar for every time Sean Stewart went for a help side block and gave up a weak side offensive rebound. Like, that happened. I think there was one early last night. My yellow legal pad's in the bag down here.
There Mark was one last, did that last night in the second half.
Yeah, for anybody that understands hockey, and maybe this is more hockey video game than it actually happens in the NHL, but you'll have shots on goal that are just thrown at the goalie so that he blockers it off and it bounces to a teammate. You shoot from one side and it goes to a teammate on the other side. I get the sense that sometimes, like, teams are doing that and just throwing the ball off the backboard to a teammate. It's the one place you can throw the ball up and it not be deflected, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, just get it up on the rim, see what happens.
Get it up on the rim, or just – use the glass as kind of an assist. I don't know. Maybe.
No. Look, what you're saying is correct in terms of, like, just get it up there, because good things can happen, especially a team that's crashing like NC State did last night. Because
yeah,
you just put it on the rim or you try and put it on the rim, a shot blocker coming from help side, like you said, is going to be out of position. And my college coach was all like, I played with a guy, he broke the shot block record in 3 years and held the record. He did it in 3 years. But he was always cussed out in film sessions because he would try and block shots that didn't need to be blockable. They're low percentage shots. Don't go for them. Go get the rebound, because what happened is he put himself out of position, like we're talking about. His guy would get the putback and easy lay in. Like, that's a real thing. Yeah. It's a blessing and a curse to be that athletic. It really is.
Yep. So, look, Sean Stewart will get better with that in time.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
I still love him. I still have Sean Stewart stock. Like, he's not, it's okay that a freshman's not a one and done at Duke, but you want to see a project. You want to see, like, it's good. He made the right strides from day one to now. And there's going to be blimps in the road, but it doesn't have to be a one and done. Come back and then make another leap. It's fine. It's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, but exactly. There's to finish off the defensive thing, Connor, the one thing that I do find concerning, and it's not even for Duke, it's just it is for Duke. It's the three freshmen, McCain, Foster, and Stewart, graded out below average, and TJ Power graded out as poor defensively. And so that just goes to show the learning curve between high school and being a freshman in college. Like, you can be the five-star recruit, but college basketball is a way different speed, and it's a way different language. It really is, and it just makes me – this is going to be like an old man yelling out of the cloud, but it makes me despise AAU, because all AAU cares about is games, 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 and these kids are not practicing the fundamentals of basketball. Like, they're flying out, playing in a tournament in Cali one weekend, then flying out to Florida, and they're playing in all these huge tournaments across the country, and just – because their offensive skill set is so elite. But then they come to a program like Duke, and Calipari has said this, and I know people or Duke fans don't like Calipari and stuff, but what he said about one and dones is true, when he's like, my team doesn't practice, like, we're practicing defense the first couple months of the season. That's why we come off to slow starts. And that's true, because these guys are so lost at 18, they don't know. Like, there's a difference between help side defense from high school to help side defense in college. There's coverages. It's like football. There's a zone coverage out of a man coverage on help side. Like, it's just different languages that takes you a long time to understand. And so Duke is struggling defensively because they're still learning. These 18-year-olds never grew up playing this type of way. And so what beats them? Experienced teams that have been in college basketball for 4 years, knowing what they're doing with back cuts when Tyrese Proctor or somebody's looking the other way.
Yeah. And that's where we get into the conversation of what does Duke want to be like that. Yeah. And that's probably for another discussion for the off season or summer or whatever. But, you know, if you want to recruit the best players, then you're going to deal with the learning curve of having those best players when they're young.
Yeah. I mean, that's why Duke has, look, the Zion run was special, but that's how UCF almost knocks you out. It's almost, Virginia Tech should have knocked you out, because those guys were disciplined and old, and talent did beat experience, but it took arguably the most flashy college basketball player of all time to make winning plays at the right time for Duke.
Yeah.
So that's what makes me nervous. Makes me nervous and worried for the way some Duke fans think. It's like, well, wait until next year. It's like, I heard that this year. Like, I heard, hey, Duke's getting Filipowski back. Sophomore Filipowski, sophomore Proctor. Duke's finally getting a shooter with Jared McCain, and they're getting a senior Roach, and all the pieces of the puzzle were perfect coming into the season, but there's still going to be holes. And next year is going to be the same thing. Like, you're going to have the flag. You're going to have Isaiah Evans. You're going to have Darren Harris. You're going to have all these five-star guys, and it's great. But then the day there is going to be problems, and it's just the way of the world. Like, Duke's not going 30-0. They're going to lose, and they're going to have a bad loss next year, and we're going to be talking like this again. And I'm going to see on Twitter, Shire's not the right man for the job. The guy that's 51-16 is not the right man for the job. And it's like, what the hell are we talking about? Hubert Davis missed the tournament last year and then came back because they made one small adjustment, and they're like, hey, Caleb Love, go be Pac-12 player of the year. We just need a role player to fill your role. And that's what they did. They needed a pass-first point guard and Elliot Cadeau. And it opened up RJ Davis and everybody else's game around him. And so sometimes all it takes is kind of a downgrade. If you think, I mean, it was talent wise, it's a downgrade of Caleb Love to Elliot Cadeau, but as a team, it helped them out to take another step.
and you bring in talented transfers like
Harrison Ingram, who were role players, like, but you get solidified role players like Cormac Ryan, hey, spot shooter with a pass first point guard, and then you got a playmaking two guard. Like that roster, he did a fantastic job of filling out the roster after last year's debacle. And
yeah,
I think Shire can do it too, but like we talked about last episode, is Duke is in this one and done era, and people want all these one like five-star freshmen. You're not going to get a Bailey Shireman. You're not going to get an AJ Green that we talked about. AJ Green is crushing it, by the way, for the Milwaukee Bucks as a shooter. And you're just not going to get that because those guys in the portal, if Duke's looking at them, they want the ball. They don't want to come off the bench.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Basically, that leads me to the final point, Connor, is I drink this Celsius because it's been a day. We talked about Duke's ceiling last episode. Turmoil has hit. And so now I'm going to ask you the same question. What do you see Duke's ceiling?
Oh, my God. I feel like I'm right back where I was. I want to say it was about a month ago, maybe a little bit more, when I was on with Mark Packer and Taylor Tannenbaum. And Mark asked me if Duke was a Final Four team or like could make a Final Four. And I was just like, I don't know. I have to see how they play in the three-game road stretch that they had. And that was when they played at Florida State, at Miami, and at Wake. And they played really well in all three and just didn't execute late in the game at Wake. I think this team can still get to a Final Four, but it has to be the team that has played hard and plays with defensive intensity and gets in passing lanes. And we haven't seen that the last two games.
No,
which makes me think that if they're not going to do those things, if this is who they're going to be, they're not making it out of the first weekend.
Yeah. I mean, I'm with you. I've been, like I said at the start of the show, I've been optimistic all year. I've been optimistic. I've been the last one on the Titanic. I was going down with the ship, but the ship's starting to get closer to the water, and I'm jumping. So I think that I will be with you and say the first weekend. I'd be thrilled if Duke makes a Sweet 16. Like, this team, Sweet 16.
Are you going to throw some Kenny Payne references at me now and say you'll be ready to jump back on the Titanic?
Yeah, that was remarkable. What a guy.
I think that guy might have actually watched the Titanic movie and thought that that was a nonfiction work.
I think he did too. I think he just read the cliff notes of it. But I do, if Duke did do what I think they can do and make a run, you know, me from a week ago thinking they can make a run, now I think first round or first weekend.
It's still out there, right? Like the hypothetical of what this team can look like when it clicks on all cylinders is, yes, they can play with everybody in the country. They wouldn't be favored against some teams in the country, but they can play with every single team in the country. And that's what's ultimately going to make it so frustrating when they lose.
Yeah, I mean,
unless the loss comes in Phoenix. Like, that's what we're set up for. We're set up for disappointment if the dateline on the season-ending story is anywhere but Phoenix.
Yeah, I mean, for me, like I said, realistically, I'd be happy with Sweet 16 or better because, I mean, at the end of the day, you're not going to win the championship every year. I mean, my God, I'm 30 years old. Duke's won the championship, let's see, three times in my lifetime. So if I was like, win a championship every year, 3 years of my entire life I was happy with Duke basketball. It's just not true. Like, it's just – fans that are like that, it's tough. Like, Coach K's the GOAT, but he won 5 rings. So it's like, for 40 years, you're just like 35 of the 40 years, like, oh, agony. Like, no.
He didn't win any in his first, 10? And he, through 3 years, was pretty mediocre at best.
Yeah. And he was close. And then he was the coach that couldn't get over the hump.
Right.
How that narrative always works with coaches until they finally win one.
And quarterbacks.
Yeah, and quarterbacks. But, Connor, that's it. Oh, last thing is we want to hear from the listeners, you guys. So, Q&A, especially in this offseason, Connor, because we'll do some episodes in the offseason. We'd like to hear from you guys. If you follow, if you're on Twitter, podcast, it's @BigJLittleJShow. And if you do not have Twitter, you can email me personally and I'll read the Q&As. And my email is jordan.mann1212@yahoo.com. We want to hear from you guys. What questions, observations on the season, takes you have, and I'll read them on the next episode in this summer. And we'll do that every week just to get a different perspective. We want to hear from the listeners, Connor.
Yeah. Let's get firing. I don't know if my clicks come through, but let's get fired on some rapid fire questions and takes.
Perfect. Well, Connor, brother, I appreciate it as always, man. And I will talk to you next week after Duke's first round game.
Sounds good.